accepted it or I've gone beyond insane.
Grunge is taking over and it's a teen revolution.
I didn't realize it was its own f***ing scene.
Even though it wasn't, it felt like it was groundbreaking.
Nirvana lead singer Kurt Cobain shot himself to death at his Seattle home yesterday.
Hey, what's going on? I'm George Stroumboulopoulos. Okay, let's be blunt. 10 years ago today, Kurt Cobain killed himself. And that's the headspace we're going to be in on this very special edition of The New Music.
It's all not wonderful, but many
consciously think about our music, so we can't explain it. Therefore, interviews are worthless. Let's go.
I don't think we've ever been labeled as punk rock in the first place. We just played in the underground circuit. We like punk rock more than any other style of music.
Well, what do you think about interviews?
What do I think? Did you hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, no. Yeah. I said, heck no.
I really can't describe what changed our attitude so fast. I think, you know, I really was a lot more negative and angry and everything else a few years ago. We're not as popular as everyone thinks, or we're not as rich as everyone thinks. We've always had a good sense of humor. I don't think that's been translated very well, you know, but we'd rather laugh about it. Ha ha ha.
There's nothing to be said. It's all in the music, man. It's all in the music. It's all in the meat.
You know, for me, though, I think a weird turning point is when Nirvana bumped off Michael Jackson on the pop charts. That seemed like a really weird thing.
They were how psyched were you?
Oh, I was totally psyched.
We were just going
crazy. Just weird. It's like, you know, they're bigger than the king of pop. What, you know, it's like, what does that mean?
When, you know, when bands came through, and I remember the feeling that somebody was really on it. And I, you know, I can remember when Nirvana came through.
Nirvana changed the face of music. You know, there was a whole, there was so many bands that were literally sent to the chopping block, and Seattle was the executioner.
The whole underground scene's like coming to light because of like Nirvana success. Regular radio stations will play bands like us now. Right. It's like, I mean, 2 years ago, nobody would have, I mean, it wouldn't even have been considered.
There were times in Seattle in the fall of 91 where you'd drive around and every other car it would be coming out of. I mean, it was just like the zeitgeist that happened at that point.
Now, I suppose if you want to learn a lot more about Kurt, you can just read his journals. And if that's something that you're comfortable with, go ahead. As for me, I think I'd rather leave that book closed. A couple of things here. Now, we're not going to get too into the whole Courtney Love situation, and she was his wife and is the mother of his daughter, Frances Bean. And let's be truthful here. A few days after Kurt died, Hole Release lived through this. And that record went on to be one of the biggest and the best of that era. So her role was definitely significant. And Courtney did inspire a generation of girls in a way that Christina and Britney could never even come close to doing. But of late, Courtney's become a bit of a freak show. And that clearly is something that should be a part of another episode. Now, Chris Novoselic has gone on to be a part of a couple of bands and is currently working with an organization that actually gets kids to vote. So his impact is going to be felt for a long time. And as for Dave Grohl, well, Dave's done just fine for himself. Okay, let's have a bit of a reality check here for just a second. Andrew Wood, Layne Staley, Shannon Hill, and Kurt Cobain, all dead, and all of those guys have achieved some sort of bizarre rock god status. But here's a question. Did they achieve that status because of the way they lived or because of the way they died? I mean, seriously, had Kurt made it through that night, would we be talking about him the way we are now? Would he have turned into like a Johnny Cash or an Axl Rose? Or how about just another junkie sprawled across an apartment floor with a belt around his arm? You know who else we should be celebrating from that era? The two grunge rock icons that escaped with both their dignity and their lives, not to mention their music, Eddie Vedder and Chris Cornell. Tell us what you think. info@thenewmusic.net.
338, I really don't want to do this. This is the latest from Seattle.
These are our laboratories. These are our subjects. Adidas Active for men. Antiperspirant with sweat-activated smart technology. The harder you sweat, the harder it works. Adidas Active. Athletes get it.
Also available, Adidas Active Antiperspirant for women.
Chocolate?
Oh, no.
Rhythm and weep. Now get your gear off, loser.
Red, I don't want to show my, you know, peanut in public.
Why do I have to be with you?
M&M's. They're a handful of chocolate candy.
Call your mom at work, okay? Really?
Oh. Hunger, the one thing you can't ignore. Pillsbury Pizza Pop snacks are jam-packed with loads of pizza stuff. Deal with your hunger, get back to what's important.
Billy!
Pop your hunger.
For the man who'd do anything for more meat, we present the new Big Harp. 6 beefy ounces cooked over a blackened grill and served on one lucky bun. Harvey's, long live the grill.
This is my bodyguard, Creasy.
You're smiling.
I'm not smiling.
You're not now, but you were.
When?
5 seconds ago.
She showed him it was all right to live again.
Pizza! Run!
And they're gonna wish they never touched the hair on her head.
What are you gonna do?
What I do best, I'm gonna go get her.
The Bible says, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil
with good. These sheep that got lost, Marjorie.
Man on Fire, April 23rd, only in theaters.
I don't understand this, like, community patriotism that everyone is boasting about in Seattle, because, like, they're claiming that they finally put Seattle on the map, you know, but, like, what map?
Seattle is known for their grunge musicians. Lots of hair, lots of sweat. The word grunge just turns me on, something fierce.
Grunge is taking over, and it's a teen revolution.
We're gonna drive around and see if we can find a Vedder or a Staley or any Seattle rock star.
I just get sick of talking about the San Diego grunge sound. If I have to answer that question one more time.
The fringe always is always attractive to the mainstream. The mainstream kind of co-opt or accept the fringe, and then the fringe becomes mainstream.
Most of what connected with the people about grunge music was probably mostly lyrically, was more about, you know, isolation and kind of bewilderment and you know, it was okay to be confused, and it was okay to be kind of, you know, an outcast and all this type of stuff.
Now the Seattle scene really is a national scene or an international scene more than like this weird close-knit urban underground scene.
It's hard to believe that it's been a decade since Kurt Cobain committed suicide, and while the memory has faded for a lot of people, There's no denying what a small northwestern town with a lot of rain and a really bad ballpark did back in the fall of 1991. So on this episode of the New Music, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a look back at the moment, some of the big players, and of course, we're going to remember the life that was Kurt Cobain's, because after all, in some horrific way, this was his day. All right, let's get right to it. Here we go.
Seattle was settled on November 13th, 1851 by the Denny Party, and they did what the rest of the settlers did. Unfortunately, they stole the land from the natives. But let's move on.
Seattle won a Stanley Cup in the 1916-17 season, elected the first woman as the mayor of a major city in the United States back in 1926, and her name was Bertha. They also hosted the World's Fair back in 1962, where they built many city landmarks, including the lovely Needle. And, one more thing. April 71, first Starbucks was open.
But let's go back for a bit. Within a span of 6 years, from November 27th, 1942 to February 19th, 1948, about 900,000 people or so were born on this earth, including these four. A kid from Seattle named James Marshall, one from Toronto named Neil, and two from England, one called Jimmy and the other Tony Iommi. Now, this is key stuff because they and a few others became Jimi Hendrix, Neil Young, Led Zeppelin, and Black Sabbath. And those riffs set the table for a host of young kids to dine at.
If you can just get your mind together.
So as the 1980s kicked into gear, the classic rock bands were planning their reunions, and the current crop were busy with groupies and hairspray and cream to stop the itching. Meanwhile, something else was happening in America. The Replacements, Husker Du, Pixies, Minutemen, The Meat Puppets, Sonic Youth, and REM were all eating up the college charts. And suddenly, what it meant to be a rock star was changing.
There were a lot of bands that were doing that kind of thing in the 80s and really set the stage for groups like Nirvana to be able to have the success that they had with radio. I mean, it just, you know, it's nothing that we did. We just happened to be there. We were on the fringe.
So take the classic rock sounds, the alternative band sensibilities, a couple of desperate geniuses, and you mix it with a city that gets,
on average, 226 depressing, cloudy days a year, and what you have is a recipe for grunge. So let's just go to this. Sub Pop, 1989, they put out a record called God's Balls. It was the debut from Tad. And then in June and July, released the first Mudhoney and first Nirvana records. The ball was definitely rolling.
Here comes sickness, walking down my street.
Pearl Jam could just as easily be called the Architects, you know. We were in bands with them. They've been around just as long. It's just like we haven't gotten as far as they have, so
that's why people call us the Architects or whatever.
See these hands? I built this scene with these hands. These hands!
So regardless of who started it, Seattle exploded, and the rest of America offered up their disconnected sons and daughters
with guitars, and never mind just the grunge movement. In case you think we're just a bunch of old folks looking back on a bygone era, not at all.
1991 saw and heard a renaissance in music. Try this on for size.
The year started off in a good way. Now, while it wasn't their best album, it certainly was a big one. REM released Out of Time. On May 12th, the Pumpkins released Gish, while De La Soul delivered their self-titled record. Now, July, the release of a Fugazi and a Meat Puppets record. And then on July 26th, a lot of people think grunge began here. It was the great Mudhoney sophomore record, Every Good Boy Deserves Fudge. Think we're done? Hardly. August 12th, Metallica's Big Black album and the first Cypress Hill disc. Then, the same day, August 27th, Pearl Jam with 10 and Blur Leisure Life. How about this? September 17th, Guns N' Roses, Use Your Illusion 1. And then the big day, September 24th, 1991, A Tribe Called Quest released Low End Theory, Red Hot Chili Peppers with a huge one, Blood Sugar Sex Magik, and of course, a little record from Nirvana called Nevermind.
Okay, back to the list. So 1 week after Super Tuesday was October the 1st, Public Enemy put out Apocalypse 91, The Enemy Strikes Black.
A week after that, on the same day, Soundgarden puts out Bad Motorfinger, The Pixies with Trompe Le Monde, and Primal Scream's awesome Screamadelica. You think we're finished? No, still one more.
And the year would end with a bang, late November. How do you suppose it all ended, huh?
A massive record from U2, Octung Baby. Now, kiddies, some of these bands were new, some were not,
but something was definitely on.
What branches off from that is really, it's like honest, the return of honesty for a brief period of time, you know. Mm-hmm. Just for a second, you had some sincerity, and a lot of bands, you know, like Nirvana, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Pumpkins, like everybody, you know. And it was really cool.
I liked it, the fact, I mean, when we were listening to that, when we, you know, growing up and listening to different things, and I'm trying to learn, you know, tablature to master puppets, and I mean, I can't read a freaking note of music, right? But I'm sitting there, and I'm like, this thing goes really fast. These don't go quite as fast as this. They go fast, but not quite as where they're supposed to go, right? Yeah. And it really, for me, it showed that, you know, Nirvana came out, no offense to him, because I'm telling it like I think it is, a crappy guitar player can write great songs.
Back in the day, there was, you know, you only got to make it in the business if you were the best at your instrument, or the best singer. If you could sing the highest and the longest and the loudest, you know, or if you were a guitar player, you had to play a million notes, have zero feeling in all of them, but you know, play as fast and as accurate as possible.
The singers were singing down in their real voice rather than up in this high falsetto-y, and it was the first time I could actually sing along to the bands and feel like I was sounding like them a little bit, maybe.
Now, while Jane's Addiction's last record came out in 1990, they broke up in the summer of 92, and, well, they wouldn't release another proper album until 13 years later, the impact of Perry Farrell on the alternative generation was huge. He was an architect, and his baby Lollapalooza was Gigantor.
L-O-L-L-A-P-A-L-O-O-Z-A.
And what would a movement be without a movie?
Yeah, we got that show. We got these guys are coming up from L.A. It's
great.
It's gonna be really rocking.
By Cliff. Great. Well, so come over after.
Deal.
Hey, Cliff, you gotta move your truck, man. Hey, Cliff, while we're young.
And the true test of any scene is its ability to overshadow the scene that came before it. And in rock and roll, this grunge alternative thing didn't just overshadow the rock before it, it f***ing annihilated it.
A good thing was that it, sorry, kicked the L.A., quote, hair metal, end quote, or wherever it came from. Mostly L.A., I guess most people think, kicked that sort of right back into the f***ing cave that it should be kept in.
I remember when I was hosting Combat Day Clip in 91, I put it in a competition against Guns N' Roses. And you have the ability to bleep, right? Mm-hmm. I got a fax. We didn't have emails in. I got a fax that said, who the f*** are Nirvana? So, you know what? It was, a lot of people were kind of taken aback. But you know what? 2 months later, everyone knew.
I didn't realize it was his own f***ing scene to the point that it...
Yeah, Soundgarden opened for us.
Yeah, and Faith No More.
They actually had Nine Inch Nails. It was their very first album, which wasn't grunge, but it was, you know, in that period.
And so it was interesting, that, you know, after all that was over and the dust cleared, to realize what a big scene it all was. Well, all that was going on, it was like when 93, 94, and we were actually writing, and that's when the huge sort of rift between the band and Acid developed. It was like...
And it wasn't, I remember 2 years later, you were
I think he was too stressed out about that.
That whole movement was way more than just a bunch of cool artists with some decent songs at the same time. As a matter of fact, some of the contributions they made cannot be undervalued. We'll look at a few of them right here. In no particular order, we will start with this. One of the biggest things that alternative scene did was bring hip-hop to a different audience.
I go by the name of Cootie with the flow down and go toe-to-toe to Hank Frank and Joe straight from the mass circles all the way live in 1995, Lollapalooza in a half.
It's getting people exposed to you know, what I'm like, and it's exposing me to what other people are like. Yeah, it's fun. It's fun. You see that pit going, everybody going crazy, you know, loving it.
Actually, it was just plain diversity, and it was huge. See, the whole Lollapalooza generation was constantly being challenged with music outside their wheelhouse. It wasn't just the same seven bands sounding like each other. Man, these days, most rock and roll and hip-hop tours are so homogenous, no wonder the music isn't growing and we're all bored.
Number two, women weren't marginalized nearly as much.
It was one of the first times in a generation where girls could go to a festival and not have to deal with a Neanderthal of a rock star yelling at them from the stage to show them their tits.
There's aspects of a rock audience that we just kind of want to stay away, you know? There's like a sexist, homophobic attitude that we just don't, you know, we don't need.
He would say he was a feminist, which is like a scary word for anyone to use. Still, for some reason, I don't know why, but it was so amazing.
All right, look, every major scene needs a martyr. Grunge had a huge one. We'll talk about that when we come back.
I'm here to talk about the death of Kurt Cobain because I think his death was a great loss to the music industry. I think we lost a great songwriter. He will be missed.
for the man who'd do anything for more meat. We present the new Big Harve. 6 beefy ounces cooked over a blackened grill and served on one lucky bun. Harvey's. Long live the grill.
Introducing new Nacho Italiano Doritos. Nacho Italiano Doritos, a new bold taste you can play with.
Get your gear off, loser.
Red, I don't want to show my, you know, peanut in public.
Why do I have to be with you?
M&M's. They're a handful of chocolate candy.
Hey, yo, Canada, let's go, tough guy!
The M, the U, the C, the H, the P, the I, the B, the E. It's much fun.
Hold up.
It's much fun.
Cable or satellite provider, or visit muchvibe.ca today.
Get it.
Hey. What are you doing?
I'm having a turtle. It comes in this new 3-pack.
No, you can only have turtles on the holidays.
Really?
Yeah, they come in big flat boxes, and your mom watches over them like a hawk so that there's some left when your Aunt Mary comes over. You don't just eat them by yourself.
Why not?
It's tradition.
Well, then I won't worry about giving you one.
Not that big a tradition.
Every day is a day to celebrate with Turtles, the original caramel, pecan, and chocolate combination.
Mmm, I love Turtles.
This is a huge event.
Oh, bring it down now.
I'm very nervous. Every time I have this feeling, I know something huge and great is going to happen for me. Because it's my first solo performance ever.
Beyonce Knowles, Friends and Family, is brought to you by Feria by L'Oreal Paris.
Welcome back to the new music. April 5th is the date that's actually marked on Kurt Cobain's death certificate. But if you're around back then, you probably remember April 8th as the day you heard me. It's just across the street there where my grandmother used to live, and my friend John called. He said, turn on the radio. And I did, and this is what I heard.
13 minutes after 2 o'clock, I'm Alan Cross. I just want to update you on something that was reported on the news about 13 minutes ago. Police in Seattle say the body of a man in his 20s has been found with a shotgun wound in the head at the home of Kurt Cobain of Nirvana. A police spokesman says the body has been there for about a day. Police say that they'll leave it up to the medical examiner to identify the body.
We had a feeling that this was it. There was a sense that after the overdose in Rome, things were spiraling downwards uncontrollably, and it was just a matter of time before we were going to hear about somebody dying. When the first news came out just after 2 o'clock that afternoon, we thought, okay, this is it. It really did happen. This is not a false alarm like the Rome thing was. And as we got, as the afternoon wore on, the tension got bigger and bigger, and the knot in the stomach got more and more, and then finally we got the confirmation. It's like, okay, kids, here's where we go. I got the confirmation about 2 minutes before I actually went to air with it. And it was, what you hear in the clip is just absolutely flabbergasted, unbridled emotion.
338, I really don't want to do this. This is the latest from Seattle. A record company official says Nirvana lead singer Kurt Cobain shot himself to death at his Seattle home yesterday. When police say Cobain's body was found today with a shotgun wound to the head, a suicide note nearby. He had been recuperating from last month's overdose of painkillers and champagne. His mother says Cobain has been missing for 6 days. And she says the last time she spoke with her son, she told him not to join the stupid club of other rock stars who had died early. 10 years from now, we're going to look back on Nirvana and say, wow, they were a really, really important band. But I can't, there's this part of me, I just can't help getting pissed off at the fact that the guy shot himself. You know, suicide, come on. What a waste.
On behalf of Dave, Pat, and I would like to thank you all for your concern at this time.
We remember Kurt for what he was, caring, generous, and sweet. Let's keep the music with us. We'll always have it, forever. That's the level that Kurt spoke to us on, in our hearts. And that's where he and the music will always be, forever.
When grunge came along, it thrust a lot of people who weren't really ready or interested in fame into the spotlight, and they were sucked along for the ride, and they had no choice. And some people handled it better than others. The guys in Soundgarden did quite well. Pearl Jam eventually came to terms with their fame in some way. Kurt was never the guy for it. He did not have the constitution for it. And in hindsight, this sort of end may have been inevitable.
I'm here to talk about the death of Kurt Cobain because I think his death was a great loss to the music industry. I think we lost a great songwriter. He will be missed by our generation.
When you watch that back, what do you think?
I guess there was something about them that was special. It seemed to speak to me when I was that young. It seemed to, that was a place where I could put a lot of my anger and the feelings that I had that weren't that good, or I don't know, just anything I didn't like about the world, I could go to music. And at a time, Nirvana were like the band, like the band I loved, had like all their shirts, had like all their posters on my wall. That's a pretty bitter pill to swallow when someone you kind of look up to and someone you idolize does something like that.
His great gift was to be able to take a pain, I think he felt a pain that many of us feel, and put it in music. He turned his art, you know, his art became his pain. And that's a gift. In some ways, that is some level of heroism.
I think he just really came out in a time in music where it was just desperate for something new and something with a voice for this whole generation of people that just were not, didn't have anybody to have them speak for.
I'm sure he's turning in his grave right now as far as to what he has become, which is, you know, unfortunate. He's become sort of the martyr.
Yeah.
For alternative music.
And there's some sort of strange detachment that people seem to have about death, where all of a sudden they don't look at the downsides of someone's life, or they try not to look at, you know, the side of that person's life that might have created the problem. They just sort of choose to look at the other aspects of it. And same thing with suicide. I mean, I think for the most part, people are afraid of death enough that when someone kills themselves, they kind of deify that person just because they think, wow, this person had the guts to do something that I'm terrified of. And I think that's just as silly.
All right, there you go. That's it for the program. Thanks a lot for being a part of it. Come here for a sec. I want to show you where we are. Come on. So this is the radio broadcasting section of Humber College. This is where I was going to school back in September of 1991. And this is the very spot where a guy I knew named Serge Cassano handed me a couple of mixtapes. And on one of them, contain the songs from Nirvana's Nevermind. Obviously, the songs blew me away. And that scenario, well, to be honest, it played out at schools all across North America. And that's how this whole thing happened. Because for the most part, radio and television were way late on Seattle. It was the people who wanted it, and then the industry reacted to it. So here's what I'm saying. I don't want to get too high fidelity on your asses, but let's try this on for size. How's about we all start making mix CDs and handing them out again? And don't just give them to your boyfriends and girlfriends, because you know what's going to happen. They're going to read way too much into the lyrics, and get pissed at you for something else, and you're going to miss the point of the exercise. Take these CDs that you make, hand them to strangers, leave them on the seats of streetcars, and give them to people in your class. Because if collectively we can get behind one or two bands that you know have got to be out there, then everything will be okay again, and we can say bye-bye to Britney. I'm just gonna fail, like a tiger.